So how did the Cozy AI Kitchen come to be? We're going to learn a little bit about my background and make a little tofu with AI. Let's go. Hi, I'm John Maeda, and I am so glad to cook in the Cozy AI Kitchen with all of you. Some of you have been wondering, what the heck is the Cozy AI Kitchen? Where did it come from? Well, it all starts with my own fascination with computer programming. I'm gonna guide you through a little recipe for how to become a little more like me, if that's your interest. But we're of course gonna be cooking with AI. So I wanna get your kitchens ready. We're gonna have a semantic kernel ready to go. Gonna add a few tokens into the recipe, and we'll let it simmer for a while before we make the tofu. Ready to go? Okay. So, secret origins of the Cozy AI Kitchen. First off, this show came from a sketch. I was hanging out with my buddy Ross. We were talking about how do we make AI more personable? Why not make it in a kitchen? And then the word cozy came out, and we thought, cozy. And the Cozy AI Kitchen really has a pretty simple background. I was born and raised in Seattle, and some of you who know the Seattle area know there's an area called the International District. It used to be called Chinatown, but rebranded itself as International District. And what it is it's a beautiful place, sort of, but it's a little dangerous over the years. It's gotten much more difficult for people to be there. When I was a kid, it had its challenges. I grew up in this place. It's called the Star Tofu Manufacturing Company. It is a so-called family business. I was surrounded by broken things all over the place. And so when there are things that are broken, you're too tired to fix them. And when you can fix them, you use your hands. And so I loved using my hands. And it was also very dirty, it turns out. And so I think I'm more resilient to dirt than most people. My mother had this idea that people did not know what to do with this tofu stuff. Don't forget, 70s, 80s, tofu wasn't as trendy as it is today. And so she put all these pictures of tofu cooking on the wall, and people would walk in thinking we're a restaurant. So to me, I've always said I grew up in a kitchen of sorts. Now, when I was in school, I had this teacher who said to my parents that John is good at math and art. And my parents, when they would tell other people about the meeting they had, would tell them, John is good at math. They never talked about the art. So I spent the rest of my life trying to be good at math and then coming to art later. Now, because I was good at math, in high school I had this teacher, Mr. Wakefield. Mr. Wakefield was at Franklin High School, those of you in Seattle know, inner city area. And Mr. Wakefield was the one who pulled me aside and said, if you want to go to a good university, you're going to have to take like a college class somewhere during the summer, which I knew my parents would never let me do because we always had to work during the summer. And so I asked my parents if I could like take a college class, and they said, no way, of course. I told this to Mr. Wakefield, and then like a few weeks later, I see him at our tofu store on the weekend. He shows up and tells my parents, you better let your kid go to this college course over the summer, otherwise he's not going to ever get to the college you want him to get to, a place called MIT. And if it wasn't for Mr. Wakefield, I don't think I would have gotten to MIT. I made it to MIT in the 80s, and that's when AI was just about sort of kind of big, but at the trail end of the so-called AI nuclear winter. I worked on things called Lisp machines and computers that would create the future of artificial intelligence. And then I went to art school, came back to MIT, and focused on this question of how do you enable more people to write code? Because I noticed if you can code, it's awesome. But if you can't code, you can't. And so in the 1990s, I wrote something called Design by Numbers. It was for what I call the mathematically disinclined people to write code. Now there is a resurgence in Design by Numbers. The young people have recreated it. Actually, this came out this last week. If you want to run it, it runs again. Oh my gosh. This project led to something called processing, which is very active in the arts and design community. If you're an agency, you've probably heard of it. Open Frameworks, if you're an artist, it's an open source way to build high-speed interactive graphic systems. And of course, MIT Scratch for children. So I've always loved this idea of programming in children. Programming in children, programming in adults who can't code. And so this AI moment is so important. Now, it turns out that I believe that everything can be understood as making tofu. Now, let's sort of learn how to make tofu the old-fashioned way before making it with AI. So first off, as a child, I remember we had all these bags of soybean seed from the Midwest, places I didn't know existed, North Dakota, South Dakota. And we get all these bags of soybeans, and the soybean seed is soaked overnight. You know, if you're making like a bean soup, you soak the beans overnight, you soak these seeds overnight, and they get saturated. They start growing, basically. And then what you do is around 1 a.m., you start grinding them with a little trickle of water. This is my dad putting the soybean seed into the grinder. And it gets ground, and it has a very sweet smell. Soybeans have this wonderful smell when you grind them. And then the ground mixture comes out as a kind of a, it looks like a little concrete, this little fluffy. Dad never let us touch it, of course, because of course we want to keep it hygiene friendly, but it looks so cool. And then you would drag it over to a big copper cauldron and you would scoop it one by one. You'd be careful not to drop it, otherwise Dad would get a little bit upset. And each time you have to do this over and over, we'd make like 9 batches serially. The customers would come at 8 a.m. So that's why we start at 1 a.m. And so we just keep moving this stuff around. It would boil in that large copper cauldron. And what's occurring here is, of course, like anything, it's separating the kind of like the juicy part of the bean is dissolving in the water. You keep hosing it down. I love hoses as an adult, by the way. I'm very good in the garden hose, Eric, because we had garden hoses everywhere. It gets really hot. It's boiling. And now you move this boiling mixture with a saucepan. As a child, we were always burned. Our hands were burned because this is always so hot. And you move this boiling liquid over and you send it into basically a filtration bag. And out comes what we know as soy milk. What is soy milk? It's just basically boiled soy mash with some, usually with some sugar in it. And there you have it. So you have the soy milk sideways, and you filter it even further, because this is, remember, beans, the bean particles you get out of them. You press this, so you squeeze out all liquid. This is my dad looking kind of dirty, hairy-ish, so he was a little scary guy. And you get this mash left over. People know it's called okara. It is a very dry soybean mash you can make into another kind of food, but it's not that popular. We would give it to pig farmers in the Seattle area. Everything was very heavy, so we're always carrying heavy things. And what you do is you add an extract of seawater, magnesium chloride. This forms clumps in the soy milk, and you wait roughly 20 minutes, and these clumps of soy milk go into a wooden box. If you see, there's little star divots in the box. And it's lined with a cheesecloth. And just like cheese, you place this mixture in there and you basically press it out. So we had a lot of weights to sort of press the water out of the boxes. And now this tofu is ready. It's moved over in a miniature crane. That's my mom over there, always super hardworking as well. And then it would end up in a large water vat. And the neat thing about this was the coolest thing is this is a wooden box. And so the wood floats on the water. So now you have a giant block of tofu, 10 by 6, 60 blocks. And the cheesecloth is gently removed. And now you slice it. And there you have blocks of tofu. And they're let to fall into the water and they cool. And when they cool, they become hard enough to be able to carry transport. So that's how you make tofu the old-fashioned way. But now in the AI era, what we're going to do is we're going to use GPT-4V, a multimodal model that just came out, and we're going to ask GPT-4V, hey, this is an image of tofu, generate an image prompt appropriate for DALL-E. And so now what we'll do, we're going to fire up a kernel, something you're all good at by now, and we're going to now generate the tofu image using a DALL-E model. And it says, this is the prompt that was created from 4B, a close-up view of multiple blocks of tofu stacked haphazardly in a large tank of cold water with light reflections on the surface. And let's see how it did. Whoa! Boy, that was really easier than whatever Dad did. So there you have it. We have made tofu with AI much faster and with much labor than my dad ever could have imagined. And I just want to close noting that I believe that all of you who are learning how to develop an AI, job well done. It's going to get harder each month, I think, because something new happens and you keep on coming along with me. I believe that education is a normalizing force. I literally grew up in this tofu factory, which was dark, smelly, dirty. But because of coding, I was able to leave that world and hook in this wonderful kitchen with all of you. So stay tuned for more Cozy AI Kitchen episodes. I hope you're learning along with me. And let's make AI more cozy for everyone.